In this video, I'm going to solve this question. In this question, we have to perform Goldfeld-Quandt test for heteroscedasticity in the first part. And in the second part, we have to list the underlying assumptions related to the disturbance term made in the above test. Note that disturbance term is just another name for population error. Okay. And this is the information that we are given to perform this test. Now, before I use the formulas and do the calculations to perform this test, let me give you a quick overview of the procedure that we are going to follow. Okay. I'm going to use this image as a reference to explain you the procedure of Goldfeld-Quandt test. I have taken this image from the chapter number 7 of the Econometrics textbook by Christopher Dougherty, and this is where you have to read this test from. This is section number 7.2 of the textbook. Okay, so let's see what's written over here. In the first paragraph over here, they have written the assumptions underlying the disturbance term. If you see, the first assumption that they have written over here is that the test assumes that the standard deviation of the disturbance term is proportional to the size of xi, which is your independent variable. And then this is the second assumption that they have written. It also assumes that the disturbance term is normally distributed and satisfies the other regression model assumptions. Now see, the last two lines are quite simple to understand. In the last two lines, we are just saying that the population error should have a normal distribution and it should also satisfy the other assumptions that we put on population error. The new thing that's mentioned over here is the first assumption, because in the first assumption, they are saying that the standard deviation of the disturbance term, that is the population error, is proportional to the size of xi. Now note one thing over here, that this proportional could mean directly proportional or inversely proportional. So we have both the possibilities. So the first possibility that we can have is the standard deviation of u, that is the population error, is directly proportional to the size of xi, which is the independent variable that we have. So in this case, if the value of xi, that is your independent variable, increases, then the standard deviation of u will also increase. And because the standard deviation of u is increasing, obviously the variance of u is also going to increase. On the other hand, if the standard deviation of u is inversely proportional, so if it's inversely proportional to the size of xi, then in this case, if the value of xi increases, then the standard deviation of u is going to decrease. Consequently, the variance of u is going to decrease. Okay, so this is the first assumption that we have on the disturbance term, that the standard deviation is proportional to the size of xi. It could be directly proportional or inversely proportional. And the second assumption is just that the disturbance term has to be normally distributed and it should satisfy the other regression model assumptions. So this paragraph is giving you the answer to your part number 2. You can just write these assumptions over there. Okay, so now let's understand the procedure to run this test. In the second paragraph, it's written that the n observations in the sample are ordered by the magnitude of x. So first of all, let's understand the meaning of this line. And for the sake of example, I'm going to assume that n is equal to 7. Okay, so the sample size that I'm going to work with is 7. So they are saying the n observations in the sample are ordered by the magnitude of x. So to understand this in detail, let me write a sample over here which has only 7 observations. Assuming that we have only one independent variable, then the 7 observations could look something like this. X can take the value, let's say 10. Y can take the value 3. This could be 5. This could be 2. I'm just randomly writing some numbers over here. This could be 12. This could be 1. This could be 7. This could be 6. This could be 4. This could be 8. This could be 9. This could be 11. And this could be 13 and this could be 15. So let's say this is how my sample looks like. In this sample, I have 7 values of x and 7 values of y. They are saying that first of all, you have to order your sample by the magnitude of x. So we can order the sample in such a manner that the x's have an increasing order. So that would imply that if I order this sample, then I will have first observation, I should be writing this one because this is the lowest value of x. It is 4. So this should be 4 and this should be 8. The second observation will be this. So 2 and 5. The third observation will be this, 6 and 7. The fourth observation will be this, 11 and 9. This is going to be my fifth observation, 3, 10. This is going to be my sixth observation, 1, 12. And this is my last observation, 15, 13. So now I have ordered my sample by the magnitude of x. Okay, so this is what the meaning of the first line is. Now let's read further. And you have to run separate regressions for the first n prime and for the last n prime observations. Now let's understand this line. So basically, if I draw a scatter plot over here, so here we have y values and here we have x values. Note that I'm not going to draw these points in an exact manner. I'm just randomly drawing 7 points over here. So let's say this is the first point, second point, third point, fourth point, fifth point, sixth point, and seventh point. So they are saying that you have to run separate regressions for the first n prime and for the last n prime observations. Now, what is n prime and how do we determine n prime is something that we will talk about. But for the sake of example, let's just assume that n prime equal to 2. Okay, so n, that is the complete sample size. I assumed it to be 7. I'm assuming n prime equal to 2. So if I assume n prime equal to 2, the meaning of the second line is that I have to run a regression for the first 2 observations. That means only these 2 observations. So I can put a line over here. So I'm doing some sort of grouping now. Okay, so I have to run a regression for these 2 observations. I can call this area over here as group number 1. And then I also have to run a regression for the last n prime observations. So my n prime is equal to 2. So my last 2 observations are these observations, these 2 observations. I can actually call this area as group number 2. Okay, so this is your group number 2. So what I have done is that I have divided the entire sample into 3 parts. So this over here is group number 1, this over here is group number 2, and let's see what's written about these values in the paragraph. So it's written over here that you have to run the separate regressions for the first 2 and for the last 2 observations. And the middle observations that you are left with, you just have to drop them. So we are going to drop these 3 observations. Okay. And the way they have written the middle observations is that they have written n minus 2 n prime, because this is the number of middle observations that we are going to have. In our case, n is 7 minus twice of n prime. I assume that n prime equal to 2, so 7 minus 4 equal to 3. So these are the number of middle observations that we have, as you can see over here. So now we are dropping these 3 observations and we are just working with these 2 over here, which are a part of group number 1, and these 2 over here, which are a part of group number 2. Now in the next few lines, they are saying that you have to figure out the RSS of group number 1, and the RSS of the group number 1 will be called RSS1. And then you have to figure out the RSS of group number 2, and we'll be calling it RSS2. So basically, because you're going to run a separate regression on group number 1, so once you run a regression on group number 1, you will have certain errors corresponding to group number 1, and you can use those errors to find your residual sum of squares. So the residual sum of squares that we are going to get from the group number 1, we are going to call it RSS1, and the residual sum of squares that we will get from group number 2, we are going to call it RSS2. Now, after you have calculated the RSS1 and the RSS2, we are going to use the F test. And the formula that we are going to use to find the calculated value of F statistic is this. So we are going to divide RSS2 by RSS1. It's not necessary that you have to divide RSS2 by RSS1. Basically, the rule is whichever RSS is greater, you have to take that in the numerator. So if RSS1 is greater than RSS2, then you will do RSS1 divided by RSS2. On the other hand, if RSS2 is greater than RSS1, then you will do RSS2 divided by RSS1. So keep this in mind that whichever RSS is greater, you're going to take that RSS in the numerator while calculating the value of the F statistic. Okay. And once you have the calculated value of F, then you can take a look at the F table to find the critical values of F. Now at this stage, you should know that if you want to take a look at the F table, then you need to know the numerator degrees of freedom and the denominator degrees of freedom. So even those are mentioned over here, that the numerator degrees of freedom and the denominator degrees of freedom are going to be same in this case. Both of them are going to be n prime minus k. Okay, so n prime is the size of group number 1 and the size of group number 2. Both of these groups have the same size, and k is your total number of parameters that you have in the model, including the intercept. So this is how you're going to find the degrees of freedom. Once you have the degrees of freedom, then you can take a look at the F table to find the critical value. And once you get the critical value, then all you have to do is compare the calculated value and the critical value. In this entire procedure that we have done over here, we were working under the null hypothesis that there is homoscedasticity. So the null hypothesis that we are going to write is that there is homoscedasticity, and our alternative hypothesis is going to be that there is heteroscedasticity. And once you have the F calculated and F critical, then you can just compare these two values to see whether we have to reject the null or we don't have to reject the null. Okay, so this is a quick overview of the procedure. Over here, they have actually mentioned that how are you going to figure out the value of n prime. They have given you a rule of thumb over here. So it's written over here that n prime should be about 3/8 of n. So if your n is 30, that means if your sample size is 30, then your n prime will be somewhere around 11. And if your n is 60, that means if your sample size is 60, then n prime will be somewhere around 22. Okay, so if you're not given the value of n prime in the question, then this is the rule that you can use to find the value of n prime. Now let's go back to the question and perform this test using the information that's given to us. So let's read the question to figure out the information. We are given the regression results from this particular model. So we are working with a simple linear regression model. In this model, in total, there are two parameters, beta1 and beta2. So the results are obtained for this model for a cross section of 30 households. That means the sample size is 30. So small n is equal to 30. Where y is the consumption expenditure, so that's your dependent variable, and x is income, that's your independent variable. In order to check for the presence of heteroscedasticity, the observations are arranged in the increasing order of the magnitude of x. Well, this is something that we have already discussed while I was giving you a quick overview of the procedure. The next thing that's written is the regression is run separately for first 11 observations, which we are going to call group number 1. And the last 11 observations, which we are going to call group number 2. So basically this 11 that you see over here, this is nothing but n prime, because you have to run the regression on the first n prime observations and the last n prime observations. Over here, you are running the regression on first 11 observations and last 11 observations. That means this is the value of n prime. Okay. The regression results for these two subgroups are reported as follows. So this is the regression result of group number 1 and this is the regression result of group number 2. Now the thing that we are interested in is the value of the RSS that we have got over here. Okay, so we are already given the value of the RSS that we get when we run the regression on the first 11 observations, that is the group number 1, and the value of the RSS when we run the regression on the last 11 observations, that is group number 2. So in this case, our null hypothesis is going to be that there is homoscedasticity. Okay, so that's our null hypothesis. Our alternative hypothesis is going to be that there is heteroscedasticity. So this is your alternative hypothesis. To find the calculated value of F, we have to divide these two RSS. Now the question is, which RSS will come in the numerator? Well, as we discussed, RSS 2 is greater than RSS 1. So we will have RSS 2 in the numerator. So F calculated in this case is equal to RSS 2 divided by RSS 1. And this is equal to 315400 divided by 47500. And this is equal to 6.64. So this is the calculated value of F that we have got. Now we have to figure out the critical value of F. Now, before we could find the critical value of F, we need to figure out the numerator degrees of freedom, so NDF, and the denominator degrees of freedom. As we discussed, the numerator degrees of freedom is going to be n prime minus k, and the denominator degrees of freedom is also going to be n prime minus k. We already know that n prime is 11, so this is 11 and this is 11. Now, what is k? K is the total number of parameters including the intercept that you have in the model. So, how many parameters do we have including the intercept? 2. Okay, so k is 2 in this case. So this is 11 minus 2. This is also 11 minus 2. This implies that the numerator degree of freedom is 9 and the denominator degrees of freedom is also 9. We are already given the level of significance in the question. It is 5% level of significance. We have stated the null and alternative hypothesis already. It's over here. Now we just have to find the value of the F critical by taking a look at the F table, and then we have to compare F calculated and F critical. So this is the F table that I'm going to work with. As you can see over here, the degrees of freedom for numerator are written here and the degrees of freedom for denominator are written over here. In our case, the numerator degrees of freedom is 9. That means we have to take a look at this column, and the denominator degrees of freedom are also 9. That means we have to take a look at this row. So now we have to choose among these four values that we have over here. It's already mentioned in the question that the level of significance is 5%. So we will pick the value that is corresponding to 0.05. So the F critical value that we are going to have is 3.18. Okay, so the F critical is 3.18. And now because the F calculated value is greater than the F critical value, we reject the null hypothesis. So in this case, we reject the null hypothesis. That means we do have some evidence of heteroscedasticity in this particular situation. Okay, so that was your part number one. Part number two is something that we have already discussed. In the part number two, you have to state the underlying assumptions related to the population error. Well, these assumptions were written in the first paragraph of the image that I had shown you. So you can directly pick the assumptions from there. Okay, and that's it for this question.